Joining us now in the studio to share his thoughts on the 10th year of the Maguindanao massacre is the National Chairperson of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines, or NUJP, Nonoy Espina. Nonoy, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you for having me here, and it's a pleasure.
Now, a ruling may come out in about a month's time. Yeah. How does it feel knowing that a decision may come soon? As a journalist who covered the day's events after that, and as a person who has been helping the families of the victims?
Excitement is the least of it. It's been so long, and just saying justice delayed is justice denied, and it's 10 years, so that's so much delay. But the judicial process was really expected to be slow. In fact, when they started filing the cases, we were talking to lawyers. I remember, there was Harry Roque, of course, and Tedte. Mm-hmm. We were discussing how the case would go, and they were saying, with 190-something accused and being charged altogether, we were kidding around, and they said, the first convictions we're going to get are probably in a decade. And here we are. Mm-hmm. And it's actually eerie that the prediction was so spot on. But nevertheless, I can imagine the pain the families have been going through. And even the 30-day extension, they said it really hurt. Because the original date was supposed to be November 20 at the latest. Because from the time the case was submitted for resolution, the judge normally has 90 days. So that would have lapsed November 20. Mm-hmm. But the judge asked for a 30-day extension. It was granted. So at the latest, we should expect a verdict on December 20. But the family said, it's there. We just have to hold on and wait for whatever comes.
Yes, you have been interacting with the family, and do want to ask you how they have been fighting for this very, very long decade. How are they now? How do they feel knowing that a decision may soon come?
It's really a total, the feeling of anticipation is strong. We were there last week, and we were there with them. These are probably the bravest people I know. They lost practically the breadwinners of their family, so that was a big blow, not only losing the breadwinners, but losing the economic base of their families, and a lot of them were really forced to live in dire straits. I remember one of the families, the daughters of Malabanan, she was saying there were months when they had to live without electricity and water because they couldn't pay the bills anymore. There was no support coming in, and on our part, what we helped find for them was donors who could help their kids go through school. Mm-hmm. And we actually, that program has actually graduated quite a number of them who are now the breadwinners of their family. Yeah. Unfortunately, last year, the donors informed us that they could no longer fund the program. And we did tell the families, and we felt really bad. I'm sure they felt bad too. But and we're still trying to find new sources, because we do want to continue and get them through school. So.
And just going back to the struggle, it's not just poverty that they faced, and a number of them also had threats.
Oh, the threats. Yeah. In fact, a lot of times they would call, saying there were people, moving around and watching their houses, and they'd get messages, and there were attempts to pay them off, and they didn't give in. That's why I really admire these people. It's so easy to just say, okay, take the money, and we actually, we wouldn't blame them if they did that, given their circumstances, but they haven't caved in, and say no, we want justice.
You're not hoping for a conviction, you're expecting.
We are expecting
a conviction.
Yes.
What is driving that optimism?
The charges haven't been downgraded. It's still multiple murder. And I think the evidence is strong. The testimonies are there, and I do know that at one point they just recently, I think, they told the court that a key witness had recanted. But the witness showed up in court and said, "Nope, I'm standing by my," you know. So, I mean, that's it. You know, it's. I think the chances are really for a conviction.
And the cases were strengthened, if I'm not mistaken, from the initial charges that were filed. Is that correct? From what was seemingly as a weak case that was being filed against those accused.
Well, if you talk to the lawyers, there was nothing weak about the case from the start. You know? What was strange was, you know, the lawyers were really saying, you know, when the DOJ at the time, the case, they said the case was designed to fail. Because, you know, the number of accused, and so they knew it would take a long time. And normally cases that take a long time see lawyers dropping out.
Yeah,
and, we've had four witnesses murdered. So, you know, it could have gone any which way. So, yeah.
Will a guilty verdict, Nonoy, end all this? But we do know there are other options for the suspects. They could still appeal a guilty verdict if a guilty verdict is handed down. Will a guilty ruling end this?
No. Well, of course, the case will be on automatic appeal if convictions are forthcoming, and that goes up straight to the Supreme Court. But aside from that, there are only 101, I think, detained and expecting to be, expecting promulgation. There are about 80 more who are at large, and that includes two members of the Klan. And from what I know is that there are plans to actually charge them too, but after this is over. So it's still going to be a long drawn out battle, and the families are aware of this, and for them they're also aware that you know, even justice in this case still does not give justice for, you know, they have internalized that this is all part of the whole landscape of media killings, of impunity. And so even I was talking to one of the widows, and she said, you know, we have more than 100 more cases of media killings to go through. And this is a long fight. And,
Right. As you said, even with a guilty verdict, it will not end. The struggle of the families will not end. This could be prolonged even more.
Yeah.
But when can the healing start, normally, for the families, for the children?
I guess, yesterday we were talking with Congressman Mangudadato, and he was saying a guilty verdict would started, you know, like if the principal suspects are convicted, that would be a great source of, you know, it could start the healing. But I think for the family, especially of the media victims and the others, I think it's also incumbent for the state to own responsibility, you know, for supporting them, because, you know, the cause of all this were state agents. You know, these were government officials, police, and CBOs and CAFGU militias. So the state should have, you know, should take responsibility for supporting the people that its agents killed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You're talking about looking for funds, looking for donors.
Yes.
You have an activity lined up, if I'm not mistaken, to raise funds for the families.
We do have a concert tonight. Most Bar in Matalino, and that's actually just to raise funds for their travel expenses so they can witness the promulgation, the handing down of the verdict, which is the culmination of all these years of waiting. So we hope we can generate enough to send them here when that happens.
Mm-hmm. Why is it a bit more difficult to help funds? To help find funds for the families, is it because the people are forgetting already? Since it has been 10 long years?
I don't think exactly. I don't think people have forgotten. Well, it you know, it gets out of the news cycle for a while, but whenever people hear about it, they actually remember. But you know, the cycle of donors, and some of them, like, they have this another new cause to fight, so they kind of say, you know, we have to shift resources. That's the way it is. So that's why we're in talks actually with some groups, and hope they can come through, and we're still hopeful that we can resume the scholarships.